Good morning. My name is Alodi Chapuso. I am here today with Michael Koha and our special guest, Bill Zimmerman, who is a former newsman. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My first question to you is, how is news affected by the First Amendment?
How is news affected by it?
Yes.
News is protected by it, as is all speech. You are permitted to say whatever you want. Primarily, it's designed to protect you from being muzzled by the government or any other authorities. You are to be able to express yourself freely, and you will be protected by the courts.
I think that the First Amendment, like he said, is very, it's the backbone of all news media in this country. But in the modern era, as politicians and interested parties seek to establish falsehoods as a true narrative, the First Amendment is almost, in a way, being weaponized to allow people to lie without really owning up to it. And it's critical that the First Amendment is defended, but also that it isn't defaced.
Well, that's a thought. Actually, the First Amendment protects falsehoods, as you imply, but also protects misinformation, protects
disinformation,
protects opinions that you hate.
Right.
And that's really what it's designed to do, with the idea that full discussion eventually will lead to truth.
Right.
All right. Thank you so much. Our next question is, why does my generation care so little about political involvement?
Well, I'd say you have to ask your generation that.
I think it has to do with the fact that we're bombarded with information daily on a moment-to-moment basis, and we're constantly being told how things are and how they could be simultaneously. And then as the political machine runs forward and elections occur, we are constantly shown that despite frustration, mobilization might not lead to success. So you have apathy amongst those who are most enfranchised by the administration. You know, white young people are less likely to vote than minorities now, as they become a much stronger foothold for, especially in Democratic nominations, many states now. We've seen a record number of minorities getting Democratic Party nominations, but it remains to be seen whether or not the election will be able to mobilize the necessary young minds, and minorities especially, to get those people in power and to elicit change. And if there's a point of failure, if people don't mobilize, if the Republicans maintain both houses moving forward, I think there is a danger, a risk of creating an apathy reset of, okay, no matter how angry we get at the anger, at the rage that's being fueled by fake news and by the constant claim that real news is fake, that apathy is breeded by anger that leads to no resolution.
I think as you imply, there is a frustration among young people who may feel that the system is fixed, that it's fixed against them, that it's controlled by powerful forces that cannot be overturned. And if, as you say, if that continues to be the frustration if you cannot affect meaningful change at the ballot box because the system is rigged, then you get apathy as a result, or a feeling of hopelessness, really.
Right. That's definitely my experience. You know, I've had so many arguments with people just trying to convince them to get out and vote, but they don't want to because they don't think that their individual action will lead to anything because they don't believe that their peers are going to go out and they're going to do it. And it's a matter of people entrenched in power want to maintain this illusion that their entrenchment is permanent, when in reality, you just need more soldiers to march. And I think that is critical to remember, at the very least.
Good point.
Thank you so much. Our next question is, how do we know who is telling the truth?
We don't. That's what critical thinking is for. And I mean, this man has so much experience telling the news and telling it in a way that's not meant to make you think one thing or another. I think the danger of the popularization of news media as a form of pseudo-entertainment has led to an environment in which people are told that they should think one thing, and they accept that that's what they should think, and then they defend it vehemently, and then propose that the opposite position is based off of lies and falsehoods, when that is not often the case.
Critical thinking is the bottom line, being critical of what you read, of what you see, finding places that you can trust, and there are those places. There are places where you can fact check. I think of Snopes.com is a good place to fact check. There are excellent newspapers that you can trust. You need to find them for yourselves. I'm not going to promote them, and there are sites on the internet that you can trust. But again, you've got to treat all the information that you take in critically. You have to critically examine it and hold it up to the light.
I agree.
Yes, I agree with all of that. I think another thing is that with the amount of information at our fingertips, it would do well for more people our own age to source their own information, follow specific journalists, not just organizations, but people that they know they can trust, that they have a record of good journalism, because good journalism rewards itself. If you tell the truth, people are more willing to believe and accept that you're telling the truth in the future. Bob Woodward, for example, his new book, Fear, has caused a massive stir within the Trump administration because he has quotes on record of numerous officials berating the president's effectiveness. And the president seeks to claim that those things were not said, that they were never possible, that the quotes are falsehoods. But Woodward has been reporting on the White House for 40 years, 8 administrations. His word is truth, because if it wasn't truth, then he wouldn't be able to write it and frame it as his own work.
Well, Woodward got his reputation in Watergate, and which, as you know, brought down a president. And as you say, he's a trustworthy source.
And lastly, are we in news overload? Do you think we are in news overload?
I think that people who are looking to create political apathy would have you think that we're in news overload. But it goes back to what we talked about earlier with critical thinking. You as an individual with a smartphone in your pocket, with a tablet, you control what's on the screens. And if you make sure that you're getting a healthy amount of news and you're informed, but you are not allowing it to drive you crazy, then you're not in news overload.
You're only in overload if you permit yourself to be.
Our time is done. It was a pleasure having you both here. I hope you have a great time. Until next time.